Real Chat Episode 42, Back to the Future, Part 3.
From out of the west, in a cloud of dust, a thunder of hooves, and a mighty...
Great Scott!
I know, this is heavy.
Indians!
This summer, Marty and Doc go back one more time for their greatest adventure of all. Doc's living in the past.
Don't try it, Tanner!
But he's about to be history.
What kind of a future do you call that?
I'm going back to 1885 and I'm bringing you home.
It's the last roundup.
Come on, run!
It's the final showdown.
Hey, lighten up, jerk!
Where Marty makes a name for himself.
What's your name, dude?
Eastwood. Clint Eastwood.
What kind of stupid name is that?
Doc meets his mate.
You saved my life.
I'm proud of your service.
And Tannen meets his match.
I'll hunt you and shoot you down like a duck.
It's dog, Buford. Shoot him down like a dog.
Michael J. Fox.
Where'd you learn to shoot like that?
7-Eleven.
Christopher Lloyd.
There's a fella that can't hold his liquor.
And Mary Steenburgen.
I never ever met a man like you before.
Gentlemen, excuse me, but my friend and I have to catch a train.
This summer, Steven Spielberg and Robert Zemeckis invite you.
Come on, Marty!
To the Rough Rider. Rip roaring. Rootin' tootin'. Straight shooting.
It's just a hold up!
It's a science experiment!
Rousing conclusion of Back to the Future.
Let the festivities begin!
Back to the Future, Part 3.
They saved the best trip for last, but this time they may have gone too far. Everybody, welcome to episode 42 of Real Chat, a podcast that promises week in, week out, the real world as we know it. Today we're looking at 1990's Back to the Future Part 3, the third and final installment of the all-conquering Back to the Future trilogy. I don't think I'm going out on much of a limb by saying that in general, Back to the Future Part 3 is the least talked about film in the trilogy. It shouldn't be in my personal view, but it's the one that generally puts technology on the back burner, introduces a love story, and is visually the most different. Personally, I've never thought the labelling of Back to the Future Part 3 as the least liked film in the series, as some have, is particularly fair. My 10-year-old self would go even further. It's his favourite of the lot.
Oh, your 10-year-old's favourite.
My name is Adam Stolfo, and I'm joined here, as usual, by good friend and co-host Brose Avard. Brose, how are you doing?
I am very well. I loved this film as well when it came out, but for different reasons for the first and second one. But it's good fun. It's a really good fun film. Yeah,
definitely. And here as well, good friend Andrew McCaskill. Andrew, how's it going?
Very well, very well. Maybe you should go back in time and slap your 10-year-old self. I mean, they're just sorry, that's harsh. It was funny in my head, but
we know which camp you're in.
No,
straight away.
No, I've got some good things to say about this film. Not my favourite of the three, though. Yeah.
Yep. I think a lot of people share that sentiment. And here as well, Matthew O'Neill.
Yeah.
Well, I'm very excited to have you here, Matt, because this is the closest thing to a Western that we've looked at on Real Chat.
Is it going
to
be the only Western we ever look at, do you
think? Time will tell, Matt. Time will tell. Okay. You might have some suggestions for me.
Oh, but there are some great Westerns.
I've got some suggestions for you, Adam. Fantastic. Don't you worry about that.
But Matt, welcome.
Yeah, hey, is this a prequel? Does this count as a prequel, do you think?
Or? So, I think it does in a lot of ways. I think you're absolutely right.
But there's my fact. No, that wasn't my fact.
So just to bring people up to date, Matt's had two extraordinary Back to the Future facts for Back to the Future and Back to the Future Part 2 podcasts, and he's got a third one, which he is obviously teasing Adam with now, to see if there's any more about Back to the Future.
He'll bring it in at a random moment. We'll just wait with bated breath until that happens.
Until then, we'll just keep hinting at it.
This is an episode of our Vintage Vault retrospective series, a conscious effort to tie in selected shows with something of relevance to the present. Of course, it is the 30th anniversary of the original Back to the Future this year. A lot of stuff going on in the world of Back to the Future. It's October 2015, which is obviously when Back to the Future 2 takes place. And also, The Walk is in cinemas as well, guys. And Robert Zemeckis' latest film. And I checked it out recently. It's pretty good. I quite enjoyed it. So what are some of your initial thoughts on this third one, guys?
I've always loved this film, but I've always seen it as completely separate to the first and second. I see one and two as a nice little neat little story that's being told there, and then the third one is just, here's what else we could do if we were traveling through time, and that's have a whole story based in one time period. And then it obviously brings back lots of references from the first two films and a lot of callbacks and things that were set up previously. But yeah, this is such a great fun film. For me, Westerns were a big deal in my house when I was a kid. The Clint Eastwood ones especially. My dad was a fan of Clint Eastwood and they were being played on TV around this time. The 80s weren't a particularly big era for Westerns.
No, they pretty much died out. I think there was like
Silverado and...
Yeah, I mean, I'm thinking spaghetti Westerns and that's normally where I go to. But yeah, you're right. There was Silverado. Was that Costner?
Costner, yeah.
Yeah, and then you had...
Young Guns 1 and 2.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, Young Guns 1 and 2.
Pale Rider, obviously, as well, which I think we'll touch on because it has a few...
This is shot in similar locations as well.
Yeah, or the same location. Same sets, yeah. And 85 it came out as well.
I don't know, there was something about Westerns that appealed to me, especially Clint Eastwood, because Dad was a huge Clint Eastwood fan growing up. So I think that really resonated as well about this film.
Zemeckis and Gale were big fans as well. And it obviously shows in this one, without a doubt.
I mean, I got into more serious Westerns as an adult rather than at this period, but Clint Eastwood was a big deal.
It kind of like everything just calms down after the craziness of number two, and you're getting like a basic story just similar to number one now.
Yep.
It's just a nice, neat little story set in the Wild West. And yeah, look, this is a film I can chuck on easily with my kids and they enjoy that as well, unlike number two. And not number two, part two. But yeah, it's great. Yeah, and because it's a Western as well, it appeals to me a little bit more. When I saw this one at the cinema, I don't know if everyone else got to see two and three. I don't think last week we touched on that, number two. Did everyone see
it? Well, I touched upon it saying that part two was the first one I actually saw at the cinema.
You did see that so much. Sorry, yeah, okay, yeah.
Yeah, it was all about waiting for this one. I remember going to see... I definitely saw this at the cinema and I couldn't have been more excited.
Yeah, I remember for some reason that year, I just remember this film, obviously Batman, but this film and Last Crusade, really enjoying them. And I'm coming home from this one and just like wanting to get a toy of the train at the end.
Yeah.
You know, like I just thought that was... Like I loved the DeLorean and everything, but it was just like the steam train, the time machine just blew my mind. Yep. So, yeah.
And what about yourself, Andrew?
I've always... never really been into this one. I just never really connected with it. But, you know, watching it recently for this podcast, thoroughly enjoyed it. I gotta say, I just think it does what it has to do. It gets away from all the familiar tropes of the first two films and goes in a completely different setting. And really, all the gadgetry and the special effects are put to the wayside. And it's just about really hanging out with these guys. And it's really about character and what they learn from the whole journey.
Also, the first film was George McFly's film. The second film was Biff's film. This is, without a doubt, the Doc's film.
Yeah.
Completely.
Yeah.
He's really pushed to the forefront here. And Christopher Lloyd must have had it. I'm pretty sure he had an absolute ball making this film. The story, which is a lot closer to the feel and tone of the first film than the second, definitely. Its structure is certainly the same. The time machine gets stranded in the past. There's a romance at the heart of it. And the big finale has to get Marty back to the future once more. Yet it builds plenty onto those foundations, which is why I think that this movie succeeds. But why do you guys think there's a lot of people who regard this as definitely being the weakest and why they might have felt like you have previously, Andrew? There's a couple of reasons I just want to bring up firstly. Reason one, I suspect, is the setting. I think that's a real biggie, actually. There's a reason that movie studios don't really make Westerns so much anymore, and that's because people don't tend to go and see them. And a lot of the criticism I've heard about this one is just like, nah, it's a Western and I don't like Westerns. I've heard that so many times when I've tried to defend this movie over the years. And secondly, this is the film that introduces a love story to the Back to the Future saga. I mean, obviously the other ones had them to an extent. Marty, Jennifer, Lorraine, George, the big one, obviously.
Well, Marty and Jennifer's a non-starter.
Yeah.
And it's almost like a bookend than rather an important narrative part. And then even in Back to the Future, the Lorraine, George stuff is... It's so focused on that they're his parents that it's not a romantic story necessarily. It's more a very practical, functional, they need to be together so I exist, rather than anything else. So
yeah,
this is the first time it's a real
I think
of lovey-dovey,
it's slowed
romantic.
Down definitely the pacing of this film. I mean, the first two were so frenetic and it was just, you know, one thing after another, and it was just crazy energy.
This is what it needs to do after the frenetic energy of
absolutely, it
definitely
does. Yeah, I agree.
I think it fits perfectly.
And the other thing is, it's a nice way to finish the trilogy in that we now get to spend some time with Marty and Doc, just the two of them. And in the second film, everything's so fast paced, you don't get to spend just some quality time with those two characters. So now you do. You get to chill out a bit and slow down the pace and just enjoy and see how brilliant Doc is in the past to create an ice cube, for instance. But the, like, just to see how his brain works and see him doing other things than time travel.
How great is the opening where the car just pulls up to Doc's house? And it just stays on that shot.
It's like amazing.
A main title shot, isn't it?
And it's just so slow, and you're so disorientated because the series is so quick,
yeah.
And it just brings everything down, and then you're just hanging out with them in the lounge room.
They're having a sleep.
Yeah.
Which is great. And it's just the warm fire, and it's just like it's all...
Yeah.
It's almost like it's a TV series, you know? It's just like it starts like a TV episode.
I think the movie, the very, very beginning, starts frenetic again with the clock tower scene, which is actually the only scene in the all three films that makes an appearance. And I'm obviously not complaining. I think Silvestri's... We'll get into it later, Andrew, but I think Silvestri's music in that main title shot that you're talking about as well is sort of telling us that the story is going to be very different to the first two as well.
Yeah.
Just touching on your point of it being a Western and, you know, people kind of falling off of it for that reason, I think also it's... Westerns by this stage were really gritty, like really dark. This Western's very much in the mold of like a...
It's old school Western.
It's Shane, like, you know, for part of it. It's very sweet. I mean, it looks nicer in the Wild West in this film than it does in the dystopian 1985 with Biff. Like, that was a lot darker, and you could almost imagine this should have been as equally dark in the West, you know? It's cutthroat, but it's very polished and sweet, and I think for that reason, probably just a bit too saccharine for everyone.
It owes as much to Blazing Saddles as it does to anything else. Yeah. And it's got that very colourful, vibrant Hollywood Western feel, which I think works. Yeah.
Yeah, it does now. I just think maybe then that's why.
Yeah, maybe it wasn't reflected.
Yeah, I think the Western part and the love story, which are the two points I brought up, I think they're part of the main reasons why I think part three is at least on par with part two. I think it works in its favour. I think it does exactly what it needs to do.
Yeah, I agree.
What would be the point as well in sort of going further into the future or spending too much time or more time in 1985? Like, what they do is exactly what it feels like it should do.
Yeah, and there was talks before this script was written, there were talks of it being set in the 30s. Biff in the 30s being a bootlegger, and then you got all those great, you know, Art Deco kind of feel and all the swing music. That really excited me when he mentioned that. But I think the Western works better for Zemeckis' direction. I don't know if he would have nailed a 30s film, but he can definitely nail a nostalgic, patriotic kind of Western film.
And 30s to 50s as far as like Hill Valley, it's not going to change that much. No.
Which is why I'm glad they didn't do 60s in the second film.
I think shooting a film set in the Old West was quite appealing to a lot of the stuntmen who worked on this film as well. I mean, everyone had a ball working on this. But no one talks about, this is the crew for the Back to the Future films, no one talks about the second one as being an enjoyable experience for them all, but I think people just going out into that open setting where they built a lot of the set for this film and everything, I think people had a ball.
They built the whole town.
Yeah.
And everything was shot on location. There were very little studio sequences shot, a lot shot on location. And a lot of practical effects in this one. There wasn't so much of the, a lot of quick cutting around different versions of effects to get different things to work. Like the hoverboard stuff in 2 is shot in 20 different ways. They make the effect of the hoverboard and then shoot it from all these different angles and all these quick cuts. Whereas in this, when there's someone on a horse, it's someone on a horse. And it's nice. It's a simpler feel. I think there's a sense of nostalgia amongst the crew to make a film in this style.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Definitely. Bob Gale said in 2002 that we had every great stuntman in Hollywood wanting to work on Part 3, and you can see why. Back to the Future 3 is a Universal Pictures and Amblin Entertainment release. It was released on the 25th of May 1990 in the US and the 28th of June 1990 in Australia, so 6 months after Part 2. So you were saying in the Part 2 episode, Brose, that you think that this worked in Part 3's favour?
Yeah, I think it helped. I think it helped with dealing with Part 2. I think it helped knowing you walked out of the cinema and it's like, I only need to wait 6 months for this. You know, Star Wars were 2 or 3 years apart when they were released, 2 years apart. So walking out of the cinema and knowing that it was going to be resolved soon was kind of a nice element of that film, I think.
And really, I think that's why they put that trailer at the end of Part 2, isn't it?
So
that people didn't leave the theatre disappointed with the ending of Part 2.
What an amazing filmmaking feat that is to literally not make your audience wait longer than 6 months for such two massive films. You know, how you do that? It's just, I don't think that's done now, is it? I mean, it's such a quick turnaround.
No, definitely not. No,
is that the first example of a teaser trailer as well, maybe?
I don't know, I'm always dangerous when you start throwing the word first around in cinema, but...
Yeah, it's true.
It is, when I watched it this time around, it's amazing how much of a highlights package teaser trailer feel. It's so tight, that little promo at the end of 2.
Like, it gets you excited about watching 3 immediately after you finish 2, doesn't it?
And it gives nothing away about the plot.
No, it's just a bunch of shots.
None of the gags.
Yeah.
A bunch of stunts, bunch of visual stuff that's really exciting, and the music's really good.
Yep, exactly.
Yeah.
Like the first two, it was shot primarily in California in the US. The Western scenes were filmed on location in Monument Valley and on a purpose-built set at the Red Hills Ranch near Sonora in California. This film is so nice to look at.
It's beautiful, yeah.
In a very different way to the first two.
Yeah. The other great thing is that, and I guess it's a Zemeckis thing more than anything, but you really get a sense that you're in this world. It doesn't feel like a set. It feels like a real town to a degree. They've really immersed themselves into a Wild West situation, and you feel like it's actually happening. I don't know. It's really tasty, that part of the production design and then the direction, I think.
The budget was an estimated $40 million, shot back-to-back with part two, as we mentioned as well. $40 million, so the same budget essentially as the second one. Here's the key thing, though. It grossed $244.5 million worldwide, which is nothing to snooze at. And it was also the sixth highest grossing film of 1990. But it was substantially down on part two's $332 million gross.
Yeah, wow.
So, yeah, it was certainly nothing even close to being unsuccessful, but really down on part two.
Yeah, I guess, which maybe that's the negative of releasing it so quickly.
Maybe.
Maybe the 6 months is too short.
Maybe it worked against it.
And it worked against them because people had already been immersed in the Back to the Future kind of world.
Yeah.
Bob Gale was saying, he says in the commentary, that they found it really hard to get publicity for this film because all the media outlets had just reported Back to the Future for the sequel, for the first sequel, and couldn't see anything relevant about talking about the franchise again that quickly. So not enough had changed, not enough had happened, there weren't enough stories. So, yeah, I mean, that would have worked against
what else
well.
Was out around when this came out? I mean, I know there was a lot of great films being released then, but I wonder what was released with, like, simultaneously with it. What was it competing against, you know?
So 1990, massive year for film. And I guess if we look at more family-oriented films, Edward Scissorhands came out that year, Home Alone was out that year, and Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles came out.
Oh, yes, of course.
In 1990. So there's a chance that, people were split focus on some of those. And then there were some other massive, like Dances with Wolves came out, Goodfellas, like Pretty Woman's that year. It's a phenomenal year for cinema. But yeah, I mean, it's the same thing, I guess. If you've just seen Back to the Future Part 2, and as a kid, if you've just been through all that excitement, then maybe you don't need to see it straight away. And it's a family film too, remember.
Robert Zemeckis is back, the director. What do you guys think of his work in this third one in comparison to the first two, maybe?
It's another element of his talent, I think, in terms of his direction. And the action sequences in this film as well are mighty impressive.
Oh, yeah.
And bolder and bigger in scale. And just using that, you know, widescreen locations. Obviously, as we said, he's a huge fan of Westerns. And he gets to really, you know, really push that button in this film.
Yeah, there's no question this is a homage for him for the films that he loved growing up, and he really pays tribute to them. And I think he had a lot of fun on this film. It was nice to get away from the complexities of two and even the complexities of one and just tell a nice, straightforward story. He was doing post-production for two during the direction of this film.
Yep.
And there are a lot more elements in this film shot with second unit than probably the first two in terms of the meatier parts of the film, because he was spending a lot of time in LA. But you can tell he's having a ball. You can tell that Christopher Lloyd and Michael J. Fox and Zemeckis on set just had a great time with this film. Yeah.
He's given the story credit again, just like part two, along with Bob Gale, who wrote the screenplay. And obviously this was one big long screenplay with part two, originally called Paradox. But what do you guys think of Bob Gale's script in this one?
Yeah, it just feels like it's a lot of fun for them, you know, like they've both looked at each other and said, look, we've got a time machine, let's do something in the Wild West, you know. And that comes across. I mean, obviously, they wrote the whole film and set it where they want to set it with the other two, but this one feels more like any of the others, that this is just something that they wanted to do, you know, just something for them almost, you know, just go and set it in the West. And I guess also with American history as well, I mean, you can't go much further back anyway, you know.
There's, yeah, exactly.
There's so many places you can go.
That's the start of that true American part of history, as opposed to the English-American history and then the War of Independence. This is when America became America. It's that tough, gritty, not colonial, but the settlement style. It's the, you know, it's the people making a go of it themselves.
It's the birth of Hill Valley.
The American dream. That's the birth of Hill Valley.
Which you said is in the other, when we looked at part one, it's a character in the film.
Yeah, exactly.
Like part one, it's a really wonderful set piece as well for lots of 80s kid going back to the, you know, 1880s gags, you know, like as well, which is like, you know, they did in part one with the 50s. But a lot of the funniest moments in this come from, you know, placing an 80s kid in the 1800s. It's really good.
Yeah. I guess using scenes from the first two films and then putting them in the West, I guess, is a big part of this. So using those motifs. Michael J. Fox or Marty McFly at the bar ordering a
Iced water.
Yeah, and getting laughed at and then ending up with a whiskey shot and things like that. It's just, yeah, really cool.
Cinematographer Dean Cundey's back in this one, and he makes a cameo in this film as well.
That for the first time.
He's the photographer in the festival, isn't he?
Yeah, a nice little touch. Nice little touch. They often do that. I think Scorsese did that in...
Hugo.
Hugo, yes. He's like the photographer in the Victorian times.
Nice.
Nice little nods. But as you said, it's a sprawling... epic film, this one. It's different from the first two in that they were very focused, and you know, despite the special effects, they're very small scale films and very small settings,
universes. Yeah,
Small, and then you have this huge landscape with the beautiful Monument Valley as the setting, and just the colours are different. They're more vibrant, and you've got the reds of the earth, and dusty everywhere, and just really adds that texture to a western that you love. You know,
like a lot of the crew, he must have really really enjoyed working on this one. There's no doubt about that.
Yeah, I guess, and they say that the genre of westerns is a cinematographer's passion. They just love shooting westerns because it's just there's so much you can do, there's so much you can use the light for, and you've got plenty of light as well. You're not restricted, so a lot of these DOPs just love that genre. And just the way he shoots the action scenes as well, like the train chase at the end is extraordinarily well shot and probably doesn't get enough due, because it's just it's very dynamic camera movement, and it adds to the tension of the scene.
It definitely does. So let's talk about the cast. Michael J. Fox obviously returns as Marty McFly, but also as Seamus McFly. I think it's his great-great-grandfather. Because William the baby in this one is his great-grandfather.
Yeah, so that makes him, his dad's great-grandfather.
Did you know originally when they had that part two script called Paradox that they were hoping that Crispin Glover was going to play this part?
Which would have worked better, I think.
You think than Michael J. Fox playing it?
Yeah. I think Michael J. Fox is fine in this, but I just find it all a little bit weird. Him with an Irish accent and I don't know.
His great-great-grandmother is Leah Thompson is his... Yeah. Why didn't they work that out?
We will speak a little bit about that speak about Leah Thompson. But I think in a nutshell, I think it was an excuse to get Leah Thompson. Yeah.
Gail just said they wanted Leah Thompson in it. So forget what the actual...
Forget incest
or bust.
Forget what all that would mean. But, it's three or four generations.
Do you like Michael J. Fox in this one, though, Brose?
Oh, I think he's great in this, And I think Michael J. Fox has a really good time. Obviously, he calls himself Clint Eastwood, but then he gets to play those kind of tougher moments and gets to ham it up a bit. And you can see that he's really enjoying playing that type of role, because he's not getting cast as a hero in a Western anytime soon. But Marty McFly can slot straight in there. And I think this Marty McFly is a lot more fun than the one in the second one, a lot more playful, a lot more like the original film. And he's more cocky and he's more confident.
You're right. But there's an undertone that he knows that something's not quite right as
well. Exactly. That's that little conversation. The other thing that's really tasty in this, I can mention it now, is there's some nice little role reversals in this film between the Doc and Marty, where...
The great moment, of course.
When Marty turns around and goes,
"Great Scott.
I know, this is heavy."
Yeah.
And the performances are really good as well. You can see they're having fun kind of taking the piss out of each other at that moment.
Yeah.
But I think Michael J. Fox would have enjoyed this one a lot more than the second one. And it's very playful, very entertaining.
This third film does have a lot of really, really great sequences between Marty and the Doc.
Yeah.
The trilogy does, but I think there are a couple of really key moments. I think based on the fact that Doc knows about this accident and he doesn't want to tell him about it, and how that sort of affects Marty. And
I agree. Like I said at the top of the podcast, that's one of the great things about this film is the energy between
the two of them,
Lloyd and Fox, and just how much fun they have together. Yeah.
But anyway, we said it before, but this is Christopher Lloyd's film, who plays a Dr. Emmett Brown again. It's got a nice tan from living 7 months in the Old West as well. Because he's sort of playing this romantic character for the first time. He's really been given an overhaul.
Yeah, he has. They've made him the romantic lead type. He's a bit more...
Really?
He's more stoic. He's kind of a bit...
Went to the gym.
Tougher and
really? He changed a lot. The doc's changed a lot, from the 7 or 8 months in the Old West.
Yeah, he's quite heroic, isn't he, in this film?
Well, that sequence when he first shows up, which is a reference to... Great. Which Clint Eastwood film is that a reference to?
Do you mean because of...
When he's hanging from the noose and they shoot...
Yeah, the Good, the Bad and the Ugly.
Yeah, Good, Bad and the Ugly reference there with his amazing scope on his rifle, which is amazing.
I love that.
"They'll shoot the fleas off a dog's back at 500 yards, Tannen, and it's pointed straight at your head!"
Yeah, he's the hero at that moment, and we've not seen Doc Brown as the big, strong hero.
Can shoot the fleas off a dog's back at 500 yards. It's brilliant. But yeah, I mean, Lloyd's brilliant as usual in this film, and what they do with his character is exactly what, you know, the series needs at this point.
Yeah, yeah. It, I mean, I guess it reflects the strength of the casting in the first place, that when Gale and Zemeckis prepared the second and third films, they knew they could rely, they had the talent in their back pocket, even if they didn't fully realise it in the first film. By the second and third, except for Michael J. Fox, I guess, who just coasts through as Michael J. Fox, which is fine with me, everyone else gets to play around a bit and have a lot of fun with it and do different things that they wouldn't normally do. Tom Wilson, Leah Thompson, Christopher Lloyd, they all get to really have a ball with their characters throughout these three films.
I guess she's the biggest addition to the cast. A new character, which we haven't seen a huge amount of in the Back to the Future world. Mary Steenburgen plays Clara Clayton. The role was written with her in mind, but when she received the script, she was, you know, like we hear a lot, quite reluctant, didn't really want to be in a Back to the Future film, until her kids, who were big fans of Back to the Future films, hounded her to do it, and she just sort of gave in, and I think she was quite happy that she did after the film came out.
Yeah, I think she did too, and I think she was very well looked after. She's pretty much Hollywood royalty at this point of her career, and Zemeckis and Gale definitely appreciated having her in the film, and I think she got very well treated, but she has a lot of great things to say that she's worth listening to on the special features.
Yeah. So what do you guys think of the character of Clara and what Mary Steenburgen adds to the trilogy?
Yeah, I think I quite like her. I think she's quite likable. I think she was in Parenthood just before this. Does that sound about right? And she was really likable in that. So as a kid watching it, she was instantly recognizable. And yeah, I thought perfect for the Doc as well.
Perfect.
Like that character, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
And how they keep pushing in the Jules Verne stuff, which I think, did they start mentioning that in number two, or is that purely a number?
It's the third one at the start
in 1955. He mentions it. Yeah, that's right.
At the start, yeah.
Yeah, so, yeah, I think that's like a nice connection they have. I think she's, as far as like romantic like duos go, I guess it's a perfect match. It's like it's not the focus of the film, but it's nice.
She has a couple of key moments in the film where she really gets to unleash her impressive acting chops as well.
She has in this film probably some of the more complicated, well, other than Christopher Lloyd in all three films, but some of the more complicated dialogue to deliver sincerely, because they gave her a lot of period accurate words and things to get through. She does it really well, especially the same way she's cracking it at the Doc.
I understand, because you know I'm partial to the writings of Jules Verne. You concocted those mendacities in order to take advantage of me. Oh, I've heard some whoppers in my day, but the fact that you'd expect me to entertain a notion like that is so insulting and degrading. All you had to say is, I don't love you and I don't want to see you anymore. That at least would have been respectful.
That whole sequence of dialogue for her is really intense, but she delivers it so well and she's incredible. I don't know how many actresses could have pulled it off as well as she has. She's very convincing.
Definitely.
Yeah, because some of those words are very bizarre to get out of your mouth in 1990 or whatever, yeah.
Do you like Mary Steenburgen in this film, Andrew?
Yeah, when I was a kid, I always kind of didn't like the scenes with her because it just slowed the action, and you know, it was always just a bit, it was just like, oh, yuck, you know, get rid of this stuff. But I was quite taken by the romance angle when I saw it yesterday, and and I was just like, it's a really sweet little story, and nice to see the Doc kind of have, you know, a romantic interest, and I think she's a good match for him.
Tough character to be a romantic interest for.
Really well cast, I think. Yeah. It just really fits. So yeah.
Do you think it would have been interesting if Leah Thompson had played Clara, and then there could have been like a pre-suggestion that the Doc and Marty are actually related?
Never thought about that in my life, Matt.
Great great grandfather, and this is why they're actually friends throughout the whole thing. I think they could have
had Elizabeth Shue playing his wife instead. His great great grandfather.
Yeah.
That would have been really tasty, wouldn't that?
Because then it's kind of like explains why are Marty and whole friendship thing, why they're together. It's actually because Marty doesn't related. Know, but the...
This isn't your bombshell, is it? This isn't...
No, this is no, just where I made
just,
up.
Just check that wasn't the fact.
The fact.
No, okay. That's just...
It'd be curious to see if that had been considered, because it makes sense. Yeah. They wanted to get Leah Thompson in, and they're the two obvious places.
Yeah, quite seriously, yeah. I was wondering if that had been mentioned, but yeah.
Yeah, no, that'd be interesting.
Never thought about that before, but
I like it.
There you go. Thomas F. Wilson plays Buford Mad Dog Tannen, and also Biff Tannen a little bit in the last few scenes of the film. Tom Wilson, he's great again, isn't he?
The other thing about Tom Wilson in this film, he's great as Buford Tennant, but he did his own horse riding stunts in this.
Yep.
And the little gun twirl that he does, he learnt that for the film.
Yeah, and he actually lassos Michael J. Fox in the action scene as well.
So, I think he... this guy is phenomenal.
I know.
Like I said, I don't know what happened. I want to find out more because he's so good.
Take him out of all three films and it suffers significantly.
Yeah.
Yep. He is so powerful and so watchable on screen. And the little things he does in each film, little different changes in his character.
That extra bit of work he does, that little bit of effort he puts in.
And I love that. I love the bit where he thinks he's shot Marty. And he's just kind of like, is that kind of walk?
Yeah,
he's
that
going,
walk that is hilarious.
And he's just laughing at
the cocky
himself.
Walk up down Main Street.
Such a great performance.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Just the guns is hanging off the finger, and it's just.
And when he gets up, the look on his face, I'm like, this guy is so good. And the only sad thing is he isn't in this film. I wish he was in this one more.
He isn't,
like,
is he? Yeah,
like more interaction with the doc or something like that. You know, instead of Marty.
Yeah. That scene that he has at the town festival. Where he rocks up like with the small gun in his hat, attempting he's going to shoot the doc with it.
The Derringer,
yeah. And that scene, it's so great, that scene where then Michael J. Fox just comes in and just goes, "Hey, lighten up, jerk!" and he looks at him like, "What the hell are you saying?"
I love how he looks to his
it's so good.
That whole
sequence is so good.
When the standoff with Marty at the end in the street, they're about to gun each other down. Just the close-ups of his face, like it cuts to his face, and he just looks kind of
bemused.
Confused.
He says, "How about we do it tomorrow?" And he's like, "He's just looking right. This is really great for the visual face I'm doing. It's great for."
He doesn't know what the word forfeit means.
Yeah.
Forfeit. What's that mean?
It means that you win without a fight.
Without shooting. You can't do that! Hey, you can't do that!
Yeah, that's great. Yeah,
he's really good.
He's like the actual real life version of Yosemite Sam, isn't he?
Apparently, he based part of his performance for Buford on Lee Marvin.
Oh yeah,
yeah, and that's kind of the voice and even the way he carries himself is based on Lee Marvin.
Yeah, so many great Tom Wilson really moments. Yeah, so many,
it's really good. Real
and Leah Thompson returns briefly as Maggie McFly. Really, as we said, Matt, just to get her into the film, I think.
Bob Gale says that in the commentary. Just really wanted her there, so they put her in. Even if it doesn't quite make sense, they didn't want people to think about it too much.
Yeah.
And she's good. She's fine in this. There's not much to do.
What about her accent?
I mean, it's...
Both their accents are a bit...
Yeah, it's up there with Cruise and Kidman, isn't it?
Yeah.
Was that around about
to be shorter,
yeah.
It's far and away.
A very cliched kind of American-Irish kind of accent. There's not great work there. But.
Any members of the supporting cast that you guys want to bring up quickly?
Strickland.
Yeah, he's back.
He's back. Another great little role.
Yep.
Yeah, but he has hair now, doesn't he?
Long hair.
It's great.
Discipline, son. Remember that word.
Gale says in the commentary that it's like, he's, you know, all the Stricklands are bald. He's like, wouldn't it be nice that there was one somewhere in history that had a nice head? It's so good. I haven't got any specific names to mention, but the other thing that's really, probably the best thing about the commentary, a lot of the background actors and small bit part players are old character actors that have done a lot of Westerns in their time as well. A lot of familiar faces in the bar, the three barflies, those guys have done a lot of Westerns. And then a lot of the people dotted around the town are these amazing actors that have, you know, Zemeckis and Gale are huge fans of their work in various Ford Westerns and things like that. So it's really cool to know that's what's littering the background. And then that great sequence after McFly's agreed to have the shootout with Buford, there's a couple of people that come up talk to him, and they're makeup artists and different crew that have got one-liner roles in there as well, because they just wanted to be in the film. So that's really tasty that there's that kind of element as well.
And of course... Brose, the band at the festival.
Of course, the band at the festival are ZZ Top.
Themselves.
Doing an acoustic version or an old-timey version of the song they recorded for the movie.
Yeah, and I think unlike a lot of the rest of the extras, I think they just turned up with their own outfits and their own beards. They just fit right in.
Definitely their own beards.
There's a moment where Michael J. Fox actually looks at them, doesn't he? He has a little bit of a double take. I noticed that. Like, he tilts his head and just like he recognises them, but then it just keeps on going. It's a great touch.
Apparently they were really humble on set as well. And were happy just to go with anything, happy to do retake after retake, and would actually play songs on the guitars kind of during takes and stuff to entertain people.
Yeah, it's kind of a shame they didn't get Eddie Van Halen. Then that Marty looking at them would have been even...
I'm sure they tried. I'm sure they tried.
We'll talk about it a little bit more when we talk about the music, Andrew, but some of the background music that's played is a sort of an 1880s rendition of their song for the film, Double Back.
Yeah.
So, it's on the soundtrack as well. We'll speak about that when we speak about the music. Do you guys have a favourite scene in this film?
There's a few, like when the even just at the start when Doc Brown thinks he's really happy he sent Marty home, and then he comes running into view and
a horrible trick to play, isn't it?
Yeah, passes out, and then even like this. I mean, this is the slapstick elements, but near the end when the Doc Brown, he's just like, you know, he's resigned to leaving Clara and just heading off with Marty back to the future, and he has the whiskey and just face plants on that table. Oh, yes. I mean, that stunt is just looks so painful. The table just goes flying. Yeah, there's quite a few. I mean, there's ones that stick out in my mind at the moment.
Yeah, Bryce?
We've already alluded to it, but definitely the shootout is one of my favourites. The potbelly door under the poncho, the Clint Eastwood overtones, the cocky walk that Buford does after he thinks he's shot him, like, and the reaction, the whole town when McFly goes down, all that stuff I think is just brilliant. And that's as a kid, definitely was my favourite sequence, and I just love that part. Yeah,
Andrew?
I have to go with the train sequence at the end. It's spectacular. Yeah, spectacular. And that explosion is just massive.
When the train goes over the edge,
and that's no CGI there at all, is it?
It's a model.
It's an actual miniature fucking train.
It's a model. Yeah, it's a miniature.
Right.
It's one
shit.
Fuck that.
But it is. It's like real. It's like a 1/3 scale, so it's a giant miniature.
Right, thank you.
It'd be about
feel better about it.
Four feet or 5 feet high.
It's like the ones at the Eltham. Yeah, a little bit miniature train.
Bigger than that again, I think. But
I think ILM embellished the explosion a bit more than what it was.
Oh yeah,
embellished that a lot, didn't they?
It's a beautiful explosion at the end there.
Yeah, it's really spectacular. That was shot too on multi camera, but then Zemeckis decided it was better just to watch the whole fall from one.
I just love that the silence. You just hear this is the whistling wind as this huge thing is careening to the ground. It's really cool.
It looks amazing. Yeah.
One of my favorite scenes, I love that train scene as well, Andrew, but I actually like the scene in 1955 at the drive-in, which is sort of the exposition scene, which starts up the entire film about, like, this is your mission, which then sort of plays out in 1885. It's also the main feature of the DeLorean in this film as well. So I quite like it with the 1950s wheels as well, and the big massive time circuit chip, which is like, was on the hood. You know, I also just love the setting. I reckon it's really, really, it looks beautifully shot by Dean Cundey in that sequence as well. I don't know why I like that scene so much. I just it is the
stuff with the Indians and then the cavalry and all that stuff's brilliant. Really tasty.
The Indian gag. Yeah. But just quickly as well, I also really like the scene for completely different reasons. It's a really, really great character moment between Marty and Doc. It's that scene that plays out at night.
I'm in love with Clara.
Oh, man. Doc, we don't belong here. Neither one of us. You know, it could still be you that gets shot tomorrow. This tombstone could still be in your future.
Marty, the future isn't written. It can be changed. You know that. Anyone can make their future whatever they want it to be. I can't let this one little photograph determine my entire destiny. I have to live my life according to what I believe is right. In my heart.
Doc. You're a scientist. So you tell me, what's the right thing to do up here?
Yeah, like, I just really, really... I just reckon that's one of the strong moments in the trilogy, the dialogue between the two, and how the Doc is just resigned to the fact that, you know, this time machine is the worst thing that could have possibly happened. And that line at the end of the scene where he just goes, travelling through time has become much too painful. Like, you know, it really, really resides with me. I love that scene. What do you guys think of the Hollywood ending to this film? Because one of our co-guests here, Brose, Michael Hadjian, has said that he loves the trilogy as much as we all seem to love it. But his biggest issue with the film is the end. He says that the whole thing with the time-travelling train at the end and Jules Verne...
Oh, I see, the over-the-top.
He has a massive problem with the fact that Doc's trying to give the message across throughout this entire movie about how, like, time traveling's dangerous. It's too painful. And then at the end of the film, he's just doing it again with his family.
And just can't keep a good man down.
Michael Hadgett has a massive issue with this ending and says that it's his biggest problem with the trilogy, is the way that it has the Hollywood ending.
It has a real Wizard of Oz vibe. But he's just like, your future is your own and make it your... You know, it's this kind of whimsical kind of like in the balloon off to leaving Oz, you know. Just has that vibe.
Do you guys have an issue with this ending, or do you think this is exactly the way the trilogy should have wrapped up and is part of the reason why this trilogy is still looked upon so favourably?
No, I thought it ended with a real high. Like, I remember coming home as a kid just thinking it was fantastic.
Alright, so what about
I wasn't expecting it to be, like, I didn't come home thinking there's going to be more of these films made now. It was just a real nice ending to it. I mean, I know I can see Michael's point, but no, it's a fun film.
Because Michael said that he reckons a better ending would be that, like, the Doc just stays in 1885, lives the life that he wants with Clara and everything like that, and just gives him some sort of message, like the end of part two, stating that he had the life that he'd always been wanting to have. He just reckoned that, like, you know, the Doc should have just stayed there in a time period which he obviously loved.
Well, that's because I always thought, how did he know that Marty was going to be at the train tracks at exact time?
Because it's not. You know. Yeah, that's exactly right. But I mean, watching it as an adult now, do you just still feel that the ending is exactly the way it should be?
I reckon Michael's got a great idea there. Yeah. I think that's a super idea. Just like my idea to have Leah Thompson play Clara. I think maybe me and Michael should have been on this film writing parts of it, or casting or whatever. But, yeah. You know.
Yeah. So, but what do you think, Andrew, of the ending?
You know, if I, again, I'd really be critical, I'd say maybe that the ending with the train is probably not the greatest way to end the series. It just, I mean, it's fine, but it just, maybe there could have been something else that they could have done. I mean, having this massive time machine that's a train, it just, I don't know, it just seemed a bit much, but yeah, it's a small qualm, I gotta say. I mean, I think it's, you know, it matches the farewell of the first two films where the time machine flies straight into the screen. You know, it just, it all, you know, sums it up pretty well.
What do you think, Brose? Do you have any issue with the ending, or do you think it wraps up like it should?
I don't have a problem with Hollywood endings, in inverted commas. It doesn't bother me if it's got a saccharine ending. If I've enjoyed the film and it ties everything up, that's fine. And if it doesn't, that's... I don't know. You can stuff up an open ending as much as you can stuff up a Hollywood ending, so what does it matter? But yeah, I like the visual of the train. It definitely appeals to the younger audience, having a train time machine. Seems like he's going backwards in terms of the technology there. But, I mean... No, I like it. I think it's fine. It's we hadn't hinted on the idea that the Doc might have a family or have a partner or something. So I don't know. I think it's fine.
I love the thought process behind that, though, about the fact that he would have had to take in the train to like 2015 or something after, and ask the company there to put a hover conversion onto the train as well. You know, not just the car.
He can do his own hover conversion though, can't he?
Probably.
He's got the technology.
We don't know how much later that this is actually said. He's got two kids. Like, you know, he could have been like, you know, he's obviously been time traveling for forever.
When I watched the Blu-ray, I didn't notice the little incident with the boy this time.
Here we go. I was just about to bring this up.
Yeah.
Have you guys seen this?
Has this been removed from the Blu-ray?
Nope.
Is it still there?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, I didn't notice it. I was looking out for it, but I didn't notice it.
You know, he's got the two kids, Jules and Vern. Have you guys seen the really weird shot where one of the kids does something really creepy? It's definitely on YouTube.
He points at his penis.
Yeah, but no, he goes like this.
Yeah, he says he's kind of like, come here, and then points at his penis.
With a really creepy look on his face. This little kid, the younger of the two. It's really, really bizarre. And if you notice this, you'll never be able to watch the movie again without noticing it.
So you definitely noticed it on the Blu-ray?
Oh, yeah, it's definitely there.
I couldn't see it.
They haven't changed it. No way. Yeah.
What was he doing then?
Nobody knows. But it's really creepy.
The theory is that he needed to go to the toilet.
Right.
And he knew he wasn't allowed to interrupt the shot, but he was just kind of indicating, I really need to go to the bathroom. That's the theory. But otherwise, it looks like he's being sleazy. But there's no way a 7-year-old kid is indicating...
I reckon he's younger than seven.
Well, it's 5-year-old kid is being sleazy.
Or maybe
he's
just being a kid and being naughty and just doing something.
That's right. You might also know that it's something he shouldn't be doing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm. Yeah. But it's in the final cut. And fans who know about it... because, you know, when I went to see this film at the Astor, everybody laughs in that shot when a lot of the audience are just sort of like, wait a minute, what are you all laughing about? There's nothing funny about this big speech the Doc is giving at the end here or whatever, and they're laughing at the kid.
Yeah. I was
it's really
transfixed by Christopher Lloyd and didn't notice it. I've seen it on YouTube and it's very funny. But
just a quick couple little points that we've done on all the Back to the Future films, Brose, where we've picked up a couple of little things to note out for while watching.
Remember where you're going, there are no roads.
is a line that Christopher Lloyd says in this film in the in the 50s drive-in. Surely that's a conscious echo to the famous line at the end of part one.
Roads, where we're going, we won't need roads.
Absolutely. But it's not actually something that I'd ever really thought of that much it actually was brought to the forefront. It's got to be a conscious echo
there.
Of course
there. It is. Yep.
A running gag throughout the entire trilogy gets its third installment here. Every time Marty goes into the diner location for the first time, there was Lou's in 1955, the Cafe 80s in 2015, and the saloon in this one, he orders a beverage that he never actually gets to drink before being interrupted by, "Hey, McFly!" Which is great. Just as in the first film, a scene in which the Doc demonstrates a plan to get the DeLorean traveling in time with the assistance of an elaborate model, sorry, it's not to scale or painted, which is some of the funniest moments ever, is followed by the arrival of a woman who's romantically interested in one of the pair. In the original film, it's Lorraine visiting Marty, while in part three, it's obviously Clara to see the Doc.
Yep.
Nice callback there. Marty here notices that the name Frisbee, an actual pie company, and presumably thinks it's just a coincidence that the name of the flat tray is similar to Frisbee, the flying disc. Of course, the two are actually linked. The pie company gave the colloquial name to the disc-throwing game before the Whammo company trademarked the slightly altered Frisbee, different spelling, in the 1950s.
Yeah, so the story is that at the pie company, the bakers and stuff would grab these pie trays and throw them around like a Frisbee and play a kind of game with them, and that's where it started. So they were throwing them around like Frisbee discs. It's also a nice callback to the second film when he throws that ashtray at Biff. That's got kind of a reference back to that as well.
It's a really tough one to spot, but if Bob Gale hadn't pointed out in the official Frequently Asked Questions that he wrote, the bandana that's worn by Doc throughout the last scenes in 1885, like when they're trying to hijack the train and everything, it's made of the same train pattern shirt he was wearing in Back to the Future Part 2.
Yeah, that yellow shirt with the trains printed on it.
One of the big questions with this film, when in 1885, why didn't Marty and Doc use the gas or parts from the buried DeLorean? Do you ever thought about that before?
I have not.
The best way to store the DeLorean in the cave for 70 years would be for Doc to drain its fuel tank before burying it in order to prevent the fuel from rotting or otherwise damaging the machine. Before Marty left 1955, Doc mentioned how he had just refilled the car with gas, confirming that it has been buried without any. They could not have taken the parts of the DeLorean either, because it would mean that those parts would be missing when Marty and Doc found it in 1955. The time machine had been made in the 80s, and many of its parts would probably not be available in 1955, resulting in the time machine being unable to bring Marty back to 1885. So,
Sorts that out then.
Yeah.
It does.
And also because it just messes with the plot of this film. So just leave it alone.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But it's one of the big issues that fans have had about, why didn't they do this? And it's like, well, you know,
there's reasons.
There's definitely reasons. A bit of trivia here from Back to the Future Part 3, guys. When Doc and Marty are at the drive-in preparing the DeLorean for the trip to 1885, Marty mentions Clint Eastwood, and Doc replies, "Clint who?" In this shot, there is a movie poster on the drive-in's wall showcasing Revenge of the Creature from 1955 and Tarantula from 1955, containing some of the very first film appearances of a young, then unknown Clint Eastwood.
Yeah, amazing. I mean, it's one of the things about Clint Eastwood that maybe listeners aren't aware of, but his career didn't really start in earnest until he was in his late 30s, early 40s. He was quite old when he became the Clint Eastwood we know and love. Now, he'd done Rawhide on TV, which was a reasonable hit for a Western TV show. So that he was kind of more of a TV actor, not a big a film actor. And then, it wasn't until he was a bit older that he became a big, well-known star. So it's quite feasible that Doc Brown's never heard of him. Yeah.
And when Marty makes that reference as well, like Clint Eastwood, he actually gestures towards the posters as well. So there is, it's definitely there. Clint Eastwood was also asked for permission about his name being used for Marty in the film. He consented and was said to be quite tickled by the homage. So, that all went nice and smoothly for them, thankfully.
It's, that's real funny. That's what he said.
Is that your Clint Eastwood?
I thought it was maybe James Stewart's back again. He appears in every show.
Wow, he's so prolific, James Stewart. It's incredible.
When Mad Dog tried to lynch Marty, Michael J. Fox was accidentally hanged, rendering him unconscious for a short time.
It was a very dangerous stunt, even though he was wired up and cabled up. It didn't quite go to plan.
I think it was just for some of the close-ups. I think they used stuntmen for some of the distant shots, but some of the close-ups, Michael J. was actually hung there. So, a bit of a one of those little stunt errors that happens occasionally. This is interesting as well. Buford Tannen is arrested by Marshall Strickland's deputy rather than the marshal himself. During the arrest, when the charge robbing the Pine City stage is read, the camera cuts away to Marty and Doc at this point. There's a reason for this. Buford was originally arrested for the murder of Marshall Strickland, which we'll get to when we talk about the deleted scenes. The murder scene was deleted as it was deemed too dark for a family film and the line was dubbed over. Now, when we talk about the scene as well, this is probably the most violent scene in the Back to the Future trilogy as well. And that's probably a good cut. That yeah, Buford is arrested for a robbery rather than a murder.
Well, see, at the moment, I think the Marty McFly-Buford sequence is quite violent anyway. Marty lands quite a bunch of good punches in there. Like, it's a fairly graphic... That's the most graphic fight scene in the whole trilogy. In the first film, George McFly lands one punch on him.
Mm. Yeah.
Whereas in this one, it's... Yeah, it's quite...
He's punched numerous times.
Numerous times. Yeah, which is quite violent for this trilogy, I think.
Yeah.
And then for that to be in there as well.
Marty gets shot as well.
He gets shot down. Yeah,
see that.
The other thing, too, about including that part of the story, Strickland getting killed, is that it then upset the rhythm of the film and that... Basically, they wanted Buford dead. If Strickland had been killed, that wasn't where they were going with it. So it didn't quite work. The rhythm didn't work.
I don't know. I think it would have added to the darkness of the West, though, as well. Maybe that...
It might have brought a bit more realism.
The film. Yeah, like, you know, it's brutal, and it then puts... you know, maybe Doc Brown would be thinking, I've got to get out of here as well, and I've got to take Clara with me rather than I want to hang around here. Because I just don't buy that kind of, you know.
Yeah. I think... The only thing that gets with this change, I think the only thing that gets affected is the fact that it is kind of weird the way the deputy comes and arrests him rather than Strickland.
You know? Yeah, you're going to feel like you need to do it.
Yeah.
But there is a sense with Strickland that he's not around all the time at the festival. He's kind of like, oh, I didn't know you were back. So you get the feeling as a marshal that he's not tied to that town, but he is out and about.
Yeah, that's true.
Quite a lot. So
there are ways to explain it. Yeah,
that's the sense I got anyway. Yeah.
In the first Back to the Future, Doc tells Marty that he was inspired to create the flux capacitor after hitting his head on the bathroom sink while trying to hang a clock over his toilet. In this one, when Doc freaks out after seeing Marty in his house and runs into the bathroom at the very start, you can see the clock hanging above the toilet he slipped on. Nice little reference back to the first one there.
And it helps explain why he's hanging a clock in the bathroom. It's a full bathroom, not just a toilet. It's kind of implied in the first film that he was hanging it over the toilet in just like a, you know, commode or whatever.
Yeah.
But you see it's a full bathroom with a clock. And
yeah.
Yeah. It's kind of like, oh, that makes more sense.
Just one of those great like things that the filmmakers put in there that you know, references the other ones. Also, just quickly as well, I haven't got this in the notes here, but the gun that the doc uses, you know, just, you know, when he's in the drive-in, he's like, you know, shoots it into the air and we're like, you know, tells Marty to, you know, when I fire the gun, I want to time this or whatever. That gun is the same gun that the doc has in the first one with the Libyans. You know,
oh, yeah, of course.
You know, the one that jams?
Yeah.
He pulls it out, tries to fire at them, and it jams. Right, yeah, it's exactly the same gun. Yeah, nice. So he's been holding on to that for at least 30 years.
Yeah.
The name on the manure wagon in 1985 reads A. Jones. In Back to the Future, the first one, the name on the manure truck from 1955 reads D. Jones.
Oh, there you go.
So that's not one of those gags where like the Statler Toyota thing we mentioned in the first one.
Yeah, exactly. It's nice.
Yeah. Probably one of the best little shots with a lot of information in it is in the scene where, you know, the Marty and the Doc are looking at the map. They're trying to work out where they're going to, like, you know, run the train. Clara can be seen behind Marty and Doc while looking at this map at the train station because she's there waiting, of course, to be picked up by Doc, who never shows up. And that's why she goes out with her carriage with the horses and does it herself because no one picks her up. It's just a nice little reference that she actually is there standing there with her back to us in her blue outfit.
Yeah, that's cool. So originally the ravine is Clara's ravine. Clayton ravine because she falls off the ravine and dies. And the doc knew that, which is why he went to the station to pick her up. But then in this version, because Marty's there, he doesn't go to the station to pick her up.
Correct.
He then saves her instead. And the reason it's okay for the doc and her to hook up is because in actual history, she would have been dead. So he's not upsetting the time-space continuum by being with her and taking her into the future or whatever because she didn't exist.
And there's a nice moment where he refers to the ravine as... He goes, I don't know why this map calls this Shonash Ravine. Must be the old Indian name for it or something.
Yeah.
Obviously, it doesn't have the name Clayton Ravine yet because she's not dead yet.
She's not dead.
Yeah. And in that exact same shot with Mary Steenburgen in the background with her back to the camera... You can actually see that the clock is arriving on the same train that she arrived on. You know, the iconic clock from the clock tower.
Yep.
Do you know what time is on the clock in the background of this shot? 10:04.
Of course.
Yeah. Just a really nice little reference there to the first
staggering
one.
Staggering that stuff, isn't it? Just the attention to detail.
They know it
incredible.
As well. You know what I mean?
Like, that's why these films are great.
I think you mentioned
I'm a little bit worried about Bob Gale, though. Has he been diagnosed?
I think, yeah, there's something something at work there.
It's weird, though, that they go to all this trouble with that stuff, but then have Leah Thompson play.
Yeah, just because they want to get her in.
So we'll really work hard on all this stuff, but just fuck the family line. We'll just chuck her in, you know? Yeah.
I think you mentioned this before, Brose, but each of Needle's henchmen come from one of the other gangs in the trilogy.
Yeah, which is at the end on the red truck, yeah.
Yeah, J.J. Cohen played Skinhead in Biff's gang in Back to the Future 1 and Back to the Future 2 as well. Ricky Dean Logan played Data in Griff's gang in Back to the Future 2 in the future. And Christopher Wine played an unnamed member of Buford's gang in the third one. This means that the only gang member who appears in all three films is J.J. Cohen.
Yeah.
What happened to Billy Zane?
He was off making The Phantom. The
yeah.
That's not true. So, 6 years later.
Yeah, the, this is a nice little reference.
The other thing, too, is that Buford's gang in the West... There's that actor there that you mentioned. Sorry, who'd you mention then?
J.J. Cohen.
No, the one from the West.
Oh, sorry. Christopher Wine.
So Christopher Wine is the only actor in Buford's gang that is an actor and the other two are stuntmen.
Yes.
Yeah.
Exactly. So there you go. Just a little bit of trivia there from Back to the Future 3. With the DVD and Blu-ray releases for this film, it was a part of a trilogy with the first two, of course. So it has the same releases and you can get all the information on them in our Back to the Future 1 episode.
Correct. Just quickly, just to save some time, don't bother with the commentary for this one. We've covered commentaries on one.
This is what you said on part two.
Yeah, just don't worry about it.
Is it as bad?
It's more sparse. There's a lot more. I actually got to watch the film a lot more in this one. But yeah, just don't bother. Don't bother. And you were saying the Q&A is quite disappointing for this one as well.
It's only about 15 minutes long.
Yeah. So yeah. Don't bother. Any information you want, it's all in the other featurettes and other pop-ups or listen to Real Chat. You don't need the... need the commentary.
I think we'll speak about it when we do our special, Brose, but overall, I think the main special feature... on the Back to the Future 3 Blu-ray is the Back to the Future ride. Always seems to get put on this one. So
we'll get on to.
We'll speak about that later.
Just disappointing that Zemeckis and Gale have not done scene-specific commentaries for any of these films. Even if they were rehashing, it'd be nice to have it neat and succinct in one commentary, and they haven't. It's disappointing.
Has everyone been on the ride?
Yes.
The DeLorean one.
It had been replaced.
Yeah, Universal Studios. Yeah.
It was great. The Simpsons by the time I got there.
Yeah. Right.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah, I did experience it the way it was supposed to be. I had a ball with it.
Yeah, I thought it was great. Yeah,
and they got Christopher Lloyd and Thomas F. Wilson, didn't they? So, it was. It felt very, very authentic. It was very well done.
Well, I'll watch it on the Blu-ray.
Yep.
Just move side to side.
Someone needs to shake my couch for me.
Andrew, let's talk about Alan Silvestri's score, because he's back, and he's back in a big way with this one. Obviously, the film demanded a number of new themes, and he certainly delivers with that, doesn't he?
Big Al's back. That's right. There's no doubt about it. Yeah, there's a real sense of rejuvenation, I think, with this score because of the setting and, I don't know, just the vibe. I think it's just a lot more lively than what we talked about with the previous score. And obviously he has some Western flourishes in there, which are really nice. There is a real nod to Elmer Bernstein in the main theme, which is just a great, fun, rollicking theme and was introduced in the teaser for part two, at the end of part two. So yeah, like, and some really nice subtle touches with, you know, some of those very familiar themes being played on harmonica, or, you know, like some of the kind of Western kind of coders.
That sequence where he first walks into the 1885 town, where they use a lot of that little authentic Western sounds and that's great. That's Silvestri at his best there.
But then there's not a lot of Western stuff apart from that. There's an initial kind of vibe there, but then it goes back to a more traditional sound.
Yeah, the music's reminding you the fact that, like, you're in a Western, but you're still in a Back to the Future movie.
Yeah, which I think is a really clever thing, because I think it would have got a bit too much if it was just constantly referencing that kind of Western sound. So yeah, and the actual more traditional stuff is a lot stronger than this time around, and some really exciting kind of action sequences at the end there with the train. He's very good at action music, Silvestri. He's the master. And yeah, like, the theme comes back in its full, you know, bodied version. So definitely a return to form, I think, with this one.
Did he have a full orchestra, just like a big orchestra again? Because we're saying on Back to the Future 2 he had a smaller orchestra. Is he...
I'm not sure.
It's hard to tell on this one.
I don't know how big it was this time around. It sounds like a larger scale.
Yeah, it does sound bigger. I love the theme to this film. It's one of my favourite pieces in history, movie history. It just gets me so excited and fills me full of energy. The Back to the Future 3 theme, I get dragged right in.
The main scene in which it's used is where the horses are pulling the DeLorean
like
at like 24 miles an hour or something.
It's awesome. I think it's phenomenal.
I love that the main theme is paused for each punch at the end with
with how good
Mad
is that
Dog. It's just like stops, punch, then a little bit more punch.
It plays that scene so well. I also love the way it's used in the original theme. I love the way that's used in the train sequence at the end, like when they're riding the horses up to the back of the train and then going over the carriages and where the original theme pops up is really well done in this one.
And it just aids the action on screen so much when Clara's chasing them with the horse. Just the sense of urgency and speed is really sold with the score in that set piece.
There's three tracks that make up that whole train sequence at the end, and they're some of the highlights of the entire score, aren't they?
It's weird, on the album release they're broken up into three parts and like spread out throughout the actual album's release, so you kind of don't get the full work, which is a bit of meddling, which probably wasn't necessary.
Don't like this. In fact, it's my main gripe with the soundtrack. We will talk about the soundtrack release in a second, but this whole playing the tracks out of order thing they do with this one, they didn't do it with part two. That was in chronological order. This one doesn't work for me that well. And I think one of the main reasons is they actually play the end of the film, like the climax with Doc's time-traveling train, as one of the middle tracks on the soundtrack. And that sounds like a track that should be at the end because of it's the end.
It's like a huge moment.
So it's just one of those weird things, and so there's
it's like the Untouchables score as well, is like that. Like they literally start the film with the end titles. It's just like, how does that work?
That's a weird decision. Really weird.
There's no explanation for that kind of meddling then, is there? We've talked in the past about rearranging them for a more pleasurable listening experience. In this instance, they've tried to do that, perhaps? Or
this might have something to do with the label, because Varys Sarabond, who are, of course, we're all very thankful that they exist for all the releases they've done over the years, but this is the only one of the three Back to the Future films that Varys Sarabond has the rights to. Might have something to do with them. I don't know, maybe they want to deliver, rather than the score as it's presented in the film, maybe they want to deliver more of a particular listening experience.
Well, it's a very exhaustive sound that Sylvester has. Like, it's just this constant rhythmic action, pounding action. So maybe they just thought, you need to break it up and a bit of a breather from it. But
your favourite scene, Brose, in this film, the showdown with Buford and Marty, the music in that part is just like, I don't know if you noticed that, Matt, is just like completely taken from an old classical western. The showdown, some of the sounds that Sylvester uses in that scene.
There's a really nice moment too, just when Marty's torn about going out and facing Buford, and it's a really tense scene where it's just like everyone's staring at him and waiting what he's going to do, and they're just eyes off his the Irish relative, what's his name?
Seamus.
They can have this eye contact, and it's just this, what's going to happen? And Sylvester comes with this really kind of eerie string motif, which is just very effective and adds to that tension of what will happen.
Gail talks about that sequence as well, which is phenomenal and quite unique. And he was saying that, every other element of this film, they'd go back to classic films and see how it was done in the past. But he was saying, in the history of Western cinema, there isn't a scene where someone turns down a showdown. It just doesn't happen in Western cinema. So they had to kind of create, the music had to be created kind of uniquely, and the whole tone and editing, it's like no one ever did it. It never happened in a Western. So
am I right as well, Matt, by saying that the whole like hiding the the so-called bulletproof vest underneath the poncho or whatever is a reference to a Clint Eastwood film?
We see that film in number two,
Fistful of Dollars.
It's a Fistful of Dollars, and Biff's watching it when he's got the girls in the jacuzzi. He's actually watching that scene, so we're actually seeing the end of the film from number three in that scene, I guess. But
that's done so well that you don't question it.
In two, when McFly's standing on the edge of the hot tub there or whatever, that's a very Western shot too, to
through
see
his legs. Yeah, completely.
See everyone,
and he's wearing the costume that he eventually changes into for that is pretty much a replica of what Clint Eastwood's wearing.
It's
in
great, just
Fistful
another one of those
dollars
things that they set up in part two before.
Outfit that Marty McFly wears when he first goes back into the West feels a little bit like a nod to Three Amigos.
You mean the one that the younger Doc dresses him up in?
A really bright, colourful one?
Yeah.
Well, it's a lot more...
It's more outrageous than colours, the one in Three Amigos in terms of colours, but it's that idea that those guys wear that in a...
It's a lot more Elvis, or even, I guess, Alan Ladd from Shane. And in a way, he arrives on the scene a little bit like Shane, especially to Seamus, and, they're being bullied, and he's kind of like this... you know, a leading light to change not the town around necessarily, but just the McFlys. Like, it's still a little bit of a nod to that, I think, going on.
Just quickly, just before we just get onto the soundtrack release, Andrew, Back to the Future 3 has, I think, one of the funniest moments in the entire trilogy. Just an offhand line, but just makes me laugh my head off every single time when he goes to the bartender.
Listen, you got a back door to this place?
Yeah, it's in the back.
Let's go, Doc.
It's in the
just awesome. It's so such an offhand thing, but it just it's absolutely brilliant. But
yeah, that, the bartender was one of the guys that's been in a lot of westerns in the past.
Oh yeah, yeah.
And used to be a roommate with Warren Beatty.
Really?
When they were younger. Crazy as that.
He would have seen some shit. Jesus.
Yeah. You're not getting a lot of sleep if you're rooming with Warren Beatty.
So yeah, just quickly, Andrew, there was the 18-track score album, Vara Sarabond. Yes. You ever listen to this?
Yeah, it's a very thorough release.
There was a complete score bootleg release, which I've got my hands on as well. But I mean, but I think one of the, yeah, it's got like 17 tracks of the score, but there is one track, which is, we spoke about it before, ZZ Top's contribution to the music.
Oh, yes.
Double Back, which is their original 80s or 90s version, is played in the end credits of the film.
Yes.
But there's an arrangement of it on the soundtrack from the festival in 1985.
Sort of like a dueling fiddle kind of version, yeah.
Yeah, but it's a great little piece of music.
Yeah. I was tapping along, that's for sure.
Yeah.
The other thing too with that sequence, they hadn't recorded the song at that point, so they were miming to nothing.
Something else,
and then they just overdubbed it. So that's why it's a little bit vague what they're actually playing.
I always thought it'd be nice if they did like a kind of old western version of The Power of Love somewhere in there. That would have been a nice
touch. They should have done something like that. But Double Back, the ZZ Top song, it doesn't really have the same... didn't really do A Power of Love with the first one, did it?
No, not at all.
Yeah.
I find them kind of weird that they're shoehorned in, but I mean, I guess it's just another soundtrack. It's another element of the movie to market. So,
yeah. But
were they big? Oh, they must have been big at that time. ZZ Top, were they? Was that their kind of? Well, it was pretty late in their career, wasn't it?
I think it would have been.
I'm going to say they've kind of always been shit.
I won't argue with that.
Thanks, man.
I won't argue with that. Not so much. They're just solid blues rockers. They're not doing anything exciting or different. And they've had a couple of hits.
Yeah.
That are kind of slightly sexist.
Yeah.
Completely.
Yeah. So,
scum.
Yeah, they're unusual.
Actually, the double back. I kind of like them now. that's a joke.
They, yeah, they were fans of the movie as well. Everyone was a fan of this.
The Double Back video clip, which features a lot of footage from the film as well, is also on the Blu-ray and DVD releases.
Yes, I didn't watch it. I'm glad it's there.
You can miss it, guys. You can definitely miss it. Just quickly, in regards to the alternate versions and deleted scenes, the main omission featured on the Blu-ray as well, Brose, is the killing of Marshall Strickland in front of his kid, which definitely makes it one of the most violent scenes in the trilogy, if it was in there, but it's definitely not. And we spoke about that. So, you know, that's the main deleted scene from Back to the Future 3. But one of the rare cuts that I could find, there's no footage of this, but it was definitely filmed. At first glance, it may appear to be just a regular old picture from when Doc and Marty were retrieving the DeLorean from the Delgado mine. But if you look closer in this particular, like, still that came out, production photo, Doc never messes with the tires of the car. Right, so the photo is like the Doc, like, you know, sort of got his hand around the tires of the DeLorean in the mine. In the good old novelization of Back to the Future 3, there's a description of what's going on in this scene. It says, Doc leaned close to the car. The metal seemed unharmed, or the stainless steel seemed unharmed by the car's long stay underground. But when he touched a tire, the rubber cracked beneath his fingers, flaking off and crumbling into dust.
Yeah, Bob Gale mentions this, that the tires disintegrated when they retrieved it from the mine, but he doesn't say whether they shot or not, but he does mention that they don't refer to it in the
So film. If this is what happens to tyres if a car's been stored in a mine for like 70 years, then what are all these tyre companies going on about where they say, our tyres can last for 500 years?
Goodyear on them. So maybe it's just, you know, one Goodyear.
And the only other little deleted scene I could find, because there's not much from Back to the Future 3, right before Marty backs the DeLorean up in the drive-in, Doc offers him his Colt gun, the one we spoke about before. You sure you don't want to take this? Says the Doc. Marty shakes his head. No thanks. I don't know how to use it anyway.
That's an interesting little piece of conversation, because they spend so much time establishing that Marty McFly is a good shot and good with a gun.
Yeah.
And the only other time we see Doc with a gun is with
the
Libyans in part one.
Yep.
And he misfires and obviously hasn't used it for a while. Yep. Or it's bizarre.
Yeah, so, but there was definitely a little exchange. There's none of this footage exists, or at least Bob Gale actually
says... I'm glad they took it out.
Bob Gale has said, apparently he's been on record saying that they considered adding this or showing this scene on the Blu-ray, but apparently the footage was so badly damaged. Yeah. When Marty gets into the DeLorean ready to drive back to 1885, the doc actually gets him to open the door again before he backs it up. And he goes, doc tells him that if he couldn't stop his 1885 death, then to get the son of a bitch who did it.
Wow.
Right? So this was definitely shot because there's a still production photo of this as
well.
And
again, that contradicts Doc Brown's philosophy on time travel.
And Marty just simply says to him, I won't fail, or something like that.
Yeah, right, okay.
But yeah, this is the most that we can find in regards to the lead scenes from Back to the Future 3. So, Brose, I don't think this is going to be as long as previous episodes, but collectibles for Back to the Future Part 3?
There really aren't any. So there's the different replicas of the DeLorean time machine. You can get the Back to the Future 3 one with the panel on top of it and the train tires, and you can get the 50s wheels tire. You can get all those variations. Mattel and Sunstar and all those guys. The Lego DeLorean that you could get had... The great thing about the Lego DeLorean kit, and I don't know if I mentioned it, is that you can come to all the pieces and the instructions to build whichever version of the DeLorean you want.
No, you didn't mention that.
So if you could buy three or four kits and build Lego versions of all three cars if you wanted to as well. So it can be the flying one or the non-flying, and it comes with the panel for the Back to the Future 3. But that's about it. There's no costumes, there's no prop replicas, there's the DeLorean, and that's it.
Okay.
Yeah, it's kind of bizarre after... Part 2 has so many collectibles available.
What was that in the Back to the Future 1 episode, bro? You mentioned the model that didn't have the DMC on the front.
Yeah.
They actually released a Part 3 version of that, which had all the rust, all the dust, the 80s,
yes,
1885's dust from when the DeLorean was put in the cave at the start of the film, because it's very dusty. So they actually released a dusty version,
like a fourth or fifth. Is that like a fourth or fifth different DeLorean?
Oh yeah, but I guess I was just trying to, you know, Sunstar hadn't released a version like that or anything. So
it's bizarre because you could get the General Lee from the Dukes of Hazzard with dust on it as well. So the dust or the non-dust version.
Leave it on the shelf.
Yeah,
for a week or so, and
it'll have the same effect.
I've got the Bluesmobile from the Blues Brothers, and that's all dusty and dirty and gross, which is kind of cool. It's got all the shit on the windscreen from the finale. And
just quickly on that Indian scene as well, that DeLorean is probably the worst possible car that you want on that sort of terrain, and the movie plays that as well. I mean, obviously, there's the whole incident with the whole ripping of the fuel line, right? But if anyone's actually ever been in an actual DeLorean before, it is like driving on the road.
Yeah.
You are so low. And so
that one is jacked up.
That is so great when he goes back to 1885 and then, you know, he has to drive away from the Indians, right? Because you see the DeLorean is like struggling big time on that terrain, and it really would.
It would.
It'd be the worst possible ride ever. I love that moment. But in regards to the awards for Back to the Future 3, no Academy Awards or nominations, no Golden Globe Awards or nominations. So we had to go straight to our favourites here at Real Chat, the Saturns, Brose. and it won two of them.
Oh, nice.
How's this? Finally, Best Supporting Actor, Thomas F. Wilson.
Oh, and well-deserved too.
Oh, absolutely.
That's great.
And as well, Andrew, Best Music, Alan Silvestri, won that year. And I think we brought that up because that beat Total Recall, didn't it?
That's right. And that's the only time Alan Silvestri won a Saturn, isn't it? For the Back to the Future, I should say.
Yeah. And it was also nominated for Best Science Fiction Film, Best Supporting Actress to Mary Steenburgen, Best Director Robert Zemeckis, and Best Costumes Joanna Johnson.
Yeah, the costumes are phenomenal in this too. We haven't talked about it much.
Definitely.
And a lot of very period accurate stuff. Mary Steenburgen's dresses, for instance, are quite accurate too.
Yep. So. The Rotten Tomatoes website certifies Back to the Future 3 fresh with a score of 73%. So 12% more than Part 2, 30 positive and 11 negative. And it has an IMDb rating, the lowest of the trilogy, 7.4 out of 10. Still very good.
Yeah, that's nice.
Yep. So in regards to some of its critical response, Kim Newman of Empire gave the film 4 out of 5 stars, saying that the film restores heart interest in the first film and has a satisfyingly complete storyline. He praised Michael J. Fox for keeping the plot on the move and mentioned that Christopher Lloyd and Mary Steenburgen's romance was funny.
Oh.
What does that mean? He said that the film's ending was the neatest of all, and it features one of the best time machines in cinema, promising that this is indeed the very last in the series and neatly wrapping it up for everybody. Roger Ebert of the Chicago Sun-Times gave the film 2.5 out of 4 stars. He said that the film's Western motifs a sitcom version that looks exactly as if it were built on a backlot somewhere. What the hell is he talking about?
I don't agree with that.
I don't think it does at all.
Must have had, I don't know, a bad reaction to some food or something when he wrote that.
I know what he's saying. And Matt referred to it earlier. It's a very clean version of the West. It's very neat. It's very dry. It's very...
Sunny.
Yeah, like it is a Technicolor sitcom-y feel of the West. It's not a gritty, naturalistic feel of the West. Have a look at...
But that's the film,
isn't it? McCabe and Mrs. Miller?
Deadwood.
And Deadwood. Like, yeah. And those kinds of films that are really gritty and more realistic. But I don't think that matters. It's a light-hearted family film. And I don't think the West in this is depicted as cheesy and predictable as other family films would predict it. So,
I mean, that hanging scene is pure Western, isn't it? Just that's brutal scene.
Mm. And just the frame of the... having the frame of the town hall up. And I don't know. I think it's for me, as a kid, it felt quite gritty.
So let's just wrap this up with our traditional 5-star review system. Traditionally, Andrew, get us going, my friend.
Sure thing. I think that this film of the year, I've enjoyed it more than I had in the past. I think it does a really good job of just changing things up, and it's a really refreshing kind of take on the series. And I think it's just, I love the fact that it slows everything down and we get to just hang out with these guys and it's really about their relationship and how strong it's become over the three films. And there's a real sense of celebration too about these films. Like, there's a real sense of community with the making of the film and a celebration of all the themes within the trilogy, and it all culminates in this film. So it's more of a celebration, I think, of the three films altogether. So yeah, a very enjoyable film. Probably not as rewatchable as the other two for me, so I would give it 3 stars out of 5.
Ooh. 3 out of 5. Good work. Recommended?
Of course.
Good stuff. Brose?
I'm going to give it 4 out of 5. I really enjoyed this film. It's so much fun. It's light. It's easy. You don't have to think too much. It's like Andrew said, it's fun to spend time with Marty and the Doc. Just that relationship. It's probably the only film where we get to spend a lot of time with those two interacting and seeing what that relationship's all about. There are definitely some amazing homages to Western cinema, and it's got a really nice, respectful feel for the genre. And I just really enjoy this film every time I see it. I love this score so much as well. Check it out. It's good fun. The other thing too, and I was saying this before we recorded this episode, that Back to the Future gets a really good chance to show everything you could do with a time machine, I guess, in a time travel film, in that part two is about traveling back and forth and around and timelines and all that kind of interesting science fiction element. But this is just a film where if you could go back in time to anywhere and spend some time there, what would happen? And this is what's being illustrated. And it still has that great tension of, will they get back to the future or not back to the future, and how's it going to affect the rest of their lives? And I think at the end, it's really neatly tied up with the drag race and the choosing not to be the choosing to be a coward, essentially, and everything goes from there. So, yeah, I love this film. It's great fun.
Thanks, Bruce. Matt?
Yeah, I give it 3.5 stars. I think it's a real fun family adventure movie. I like the Western tropes that are dealt out in it, like the... we didn't touch on it, but Marty's sharpshooting, like the scene from Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid with Robert Redford. Everyone knows that one, I'm guessing. Yeah. It's just a nice little touch like that. And obviously, the Fistful of Dollars as well. So, I really enjoy this film. And I was thinking 4 stars, but I'm going to go 3.5. Because, again, compared to number one, it's miles away from that. But it's still a lot of fun.
We did miss out on that famous scene, Bruce, with the whole, like...
Hey, just tell me one thing. Where did you learn to shoot like that?
7-Eleven.
Yeah, that's great. Actually, we nearly missed out on my fact.
Oh, it's Jesus. Time for the fact.
I think it is time, Matt.
Yeah, just quickly. So I don't know how amazing this one is. Nowhere near as amazing as the Leah Thompson's dress one. But Clint Eastwood appears again in the Back to the Future story in the game. And Marty McFly becomes Harry Callinan, which is Dirty Harry.
Oh, nice.
Oh, right.
It's that's a name. He's a detective in the 30s, if anyone gets to play that game, and it's Harry Callinan.
So, oh, wow.
Did you know that? No one knew that.
No. I haven't played him through enough. He's done that 3 episodes in a row.
Boom.
He's got me.
Boom.
Nice work, Matt. Very
thanks,
impressive.
Man. Thanks.
Very, very impressive.
Matt looks like he wants to just drop his mic like a rat. Walk, I'm done now. I've nothing more to say.
He's not coming back.
Mike is on the ground.
Nice work, Matt. So yeah, look, final words on this trilogy. The closing moments of this film still bring a lump to my throat, Brose. watching the time machine smashed to little pieces is like the end of an era. You know, as much as I love this film, that scene just always gets to me when I see the DeLorean smashed by the train. But that weird thing with the train driver, he doesn't even stop. He just keeps on going
No.
He wasn't a fan of the series, clearly.
By 1990, that was a popular way to dispose of unwanted DeLoreans.
Oh, just put them on train tracks.
Put them on a train. Like, that guy had already done three on that trip already. It happened all the time.
But look, I'm not going to argue that Back to the Future Part 3 is a perfect film. It's certainly not. It's certainly a strong film, and it bothers to put together an epilogue that comfortably pulls together the remaining narrative strands from the trilogy in a really effective way. I think this is just a really, really great, lovely movie. It's compelling and exciting. It's been unfairly underappreciated, I think, as well. Compared to a lot of number threes where a series really starts to go off the rails, like this one, you know, it's certainly still on par. I think so. If it falls off, it's not by much, that's for sure. I generally struggle to come up with a more convincing, rounded and compelling end to a blockbuster trilogy, even from Nolan and his big trilogy. As a standalone film, I just think it's really, really strong. And the end of this trilogy, and it's hard to think of how it could have been better. I don't know. I have no idea how they could have done a better number three than this one. It's really rewatchable, and it's a real treat. Michael J. Fox and Christopher Lloyd are in top form, as are all the supporting cast. And yeah, I highly recommend this film. And like Back to the Future Part 2, I give this film 4.5 stars, which is why I regard this trilogy so highly, because I've given 5 stars, 4.5, and 4.5, and I just don't think that happens. Doesn't happen very often, that's for sure. So, yeah, that's my review. That's it, guys. Thanks very much for coming and discussing the Back to the Future trilogy with us all. And, Bruce, we're going to give Matt and Andrew a reprieve, but we are going to come back with Michael Hadgen.
We will be back.
And we're going to look at, you know, the Back to the Future series, some of its spin-offs and
all the stuff that hangs around the side of the... There's the animated series, the ride, the video game we'll have a look at as well. And there's a few other bits and pieces we can discuss as well, so it'll be good.
Do you want me to record a fact for that and email it?
Yes, I'd love that. If you email me something, I will definitely read it out.
Can I make up the fact?
Yes.
Yes.
All right, excellent.
Yes. I'll believe you after those first three. You've just got all this cred. So, but no, thanks very much, guys, and we will speak to you guys very shortly. Thank you.
No problem.
Thank you.
You can keep in touch with us here at Real Chat by visiting realchat.com.au. Check us out on Twitter at Real Chat Podcast, Instagram, real_chat_podcast. And we're on YouTube, Real Chat Podcast, surprise, surprise. And track us down on Facebook. You can hit iTunes for new episodes and check out some of our old episodes. Thanks for listening.